This room, full of business, education, and government leaders, are excited to hear your vision for the state of Arizona, and specifically, this major region's future. Governor Ducey is the 23rd governor of the state of Arizona. He was elected on November 4, 2014, and sworn into office on January 5, 2015, inheriting a $1 billion budget deficit. With a mission to make Arizona the best state in the country to live, work, do business, and get an education, Governor Ducey and the state's leaders got to work. Today, Arizona's budget is balanced. Business is thriving, and public schools are continuing to improve. The governor remains committed to what he has identified as his top priorities: growing the economy, creating and supporting 21st century jobs, promoting educational excellence, protecting our communities, and restoring fiscal responsibility. A strong Arizona is an Arizona that ensures opportunity for all. Governor Ducey has pledged to work every day to make this vision a reality. Governor Ducey was born in Toledo, Ohio. He moved to Arizona to attend Arizona State University Business School, where he earned his Bachelor of Science in Finance in 1986. Governor Ducey and his wife, Angela, live in Phoenix with their three sons, Jack, Joe, and Sam. Please help me in extending an enthusiastic West Valley welcome to Governor Doug Ducey.
Thank you. Thanks very much. And thank you, Noel, for the very warm introduction. I miss those early mornings watching football practice. And I want to thank everyone here in the city of Glendale and Westmark for hosting me again today. This is a tradition I really enjoy. I'm honored to speak with you this afternoon about the progress we're making as a state and our vision as it unfolds. You know, we've achieved so much these last 2 years on the really big issues, and in fact, on the biggest issue of them all. And it wasn't because we had Republican ideas or Democrat ideas. It's because we had Arizona ideals. And we're going to keep that spirit going again this session. Long before any of us arrived here, nearly a century ago, our state's first governor, George Hunt, made a trip to Douglas to deliver a speech. It was well attended, but there was one young boy who stood out, explaining that Arizona was the land of boundless opportunity. Governor Hunt turned to the boy and his friends and remarked that even one of them could be governor someday. All they needed was grit, will, and determination. What Governor Hunt didn't know is that boy had traveled miles, barefoot, from a neighboring town, and for one reason, the free hot dogs. It was better than wandering the desert looking for food. After the boy's father passed away, the family faced hardship and hunger. His mother told him, "Son, you're going to be whatever you want to be. It's up to you." Well, that young boy rose to the challenge, and he stood at this same podium addressing organizations gathered here today as our state's 14th governor. Governor Raul Castro came to this country as a poor immigrant. The obstacles and challenges before him immense. But when we honored his life in our old capital, he had not only been a governor, he was an educated man, an attorney, a prosecutor, an ambassador, a diplomat, a pioneer. It's a story we don't hear enough, or telehealth, but we need to because it's a distinctly Arizona story. And our history is filled with them. Regular people who had mountains standing in their way, but they scaled them. A young secretary, fired because her boss said he needed a man to do the job. It was Rose Mofford, and she too became governor, breaking the glass ceiling and paving the way for Arizona to earn the proud distinction of having more women governors than any other state in the nation. A young boy whose single mother packed him in a car and drove him from Chicago to Tucson to start a new life. He'd take a paper route to help his family make ends meet. But it was the billboards he saw along the highway from Illinois to Arizona that would captivate his imagination. Today, Carl Eller is not only a rags-to-riches success story, he and wife Stevie are two of our state's most valuable players and charitable citizens. And then there's the story of a rebellious Air Force cadet told only men could fly in combat. Tucson's Congresswoman Martha McSally wouldn't listen and literally took women's rights to new heights. I'm proud to report that just like all these trailblazers, the state of our state in 2017 is resilient and strong. Our economy is growing, our schools are improving, and our citizens are succeeding. But now is not the time to be content or complacent, because the next generation of Arizonans, especially those facing challenges and hardship, are counting on us to rise to the occasion and do everything in our power to create boundless opportunity. To do this, we need to begin at the beginning. Because we can't claim opportunity for all unless every child, regardless of their background, has access to a quality education. One of the first things we need to do as a state and as citizens is focus on what really works in our public schools. We have so much to be proud of. Arizona students are improving faster in math and reading than any other kids in the country. We've been a leader on school choice, and we will continue to be a leader. Our public charters are leading the nation and the world in outcomes and results for our students. It needs to be said, we can advocate for more resources and also admit we have so many great schools and great teachers. But too many people have fallen into the trap set by the pundits, the harsh partisans, and yes, even some in the press, of just dumping on Arizona schools. I'll admit, there was a time I didn't know the full picture. But after spending the last 3 years inside dozens of Arizona classrooms, mostly in low-income neighborhoods, I have a new appreciation for the excellence occurring in our school system. Not all of these schools are elite or A-ranked, but they are working hard to get there. And what has been most striking are the teachers. They shared with me it's more than a job. It's a calling, especially in our low-income communities. They've told me I'm not here because I have to be. I'm here because I want to be. It's no wonder that we all remember those teachers who had an impact. For me, it was Mr. Zammit, Mr. Wagner, Doc Demar, Professor Olney. Sister Patrice. If you think about it for a moment, you have your own lists of teachers who inspired you. I want the teachers of our state to know you make the difference. I value your work, and it's time we return the favor. We saw incredible success last year working together in a bipartisan spirit, putting politics aside, settling a lawsuit, stepping out of a state of constant crisis without tricks or gimmicks, and directing billions of additional dollars into K-12 education that have gone to reward many of our dedicated teachers. Some people have asked, what's next? After Prop 123, where are steps 4, 5, and 6? Well, here we go. Step 4, resources. I've made a commitment our educators can take to the bank. Starting with the budget I released last Friday, I called for an increased investment in our public schools above and beyond inflation. Every single year I am governor. Now, I'm not promising a money tree. I can't. There's no pot of gold or cash hiding under a seat cushion. And unlike Washington, we don't print money and we won't raise taxes. But when we do have available resources, like we do this year, the bulk of those dollars will go to public education. And our proposals will be responsible to make sure we can actually follow through on our word and our educators can rely on it. Step 5, teacher pay. Let's take these new dollars and put them where they will have the greatest impact on students, the place where we know we will get the best return on investment. It's time for a raise for Arizona teachers. My budget outlines a permanent, lasting salary increase to all of Arizona's teachers. This will be above and beyond raises they may be receiving from Proposition 123, or overrides, or additional dollars from their districts. This is an investment by the state of Arizona in recognizing and rewarding the work of our teachers in a way that is fair, permanent, and fiscally responsible. If we are serious about supporting public education and tackling our teacher shortage, we've got to take action on multiple fronts. And this is one more positive step in the right direction. And step six, student debt. One of the biggest challenges for many new teachers is paying down student loan debt. Doctors, lawyers, business people, many will make six figures within a few years of graduation. But for teachers, paying off the debt from their education can take decades. In some cases, it might push them out of the profession altogether. That is unacceptable. To address this, I'm asking Arizona's three public universities in partnership with community colleges to develop a plan for the design of an Arizona Teachers Academy. I'm looking for the best and brightest to commit to teach in Arizona public schools. If you make that commitment, we'll make this commitment. Your education will be paid for, a job will be waiting, and you will be free of debt. Let's lift this burden from our teachers. Attract new quality individuals into the classroom. Step six shows teachers theirs is a profession we respect and are willing to elevate. But why stop at six? Step seven, low-income schools. The greatest need for high-quality teachers is in our low-income schools, and it also happens to be the hardest place to attract them. So let's do more for teachers willing to make a commitment to these students and these neighborhoods. A $1,000 signing bonus to attract the best and brightest and continue to close the achievement gap. Nobody goes into teaching to get rich, but everyone deserves to be rewarded for their hard work. Together, we can show the teachers of our state that theirs is a profession that is valued, respected, and indispensable. Step 8, teacher shortage. For those who want to dedicate the best of their energies and skills to this noble cause, we shouldn't let outdated rules stand in the way of getting them to the front of the classroom. Sandra Day O'Connor is one of our nation's most honorable citizens. She once served in the Arizona State Legislature, the first woman majority leader, in fact, in the entire country. She's the first woman to serve on the Supreme Court. That's the United States Supreme Court. She's taught and lectured in law schools. There's actually a law school named after her, and a federal courthouse right down the street from the state capitol. But after her retirement in 2005, if she had wanted to teach civics in an Arizona high school classroom, she would have been deemed unqualified by the system. That is absolutely crazy. I'm talking about the teacher certification process, and it's time to fix it. We want the most qualified, most talented people leading our classroom. So let's get with the times and place trust in our school boards, superintendents, and principals by letting them make the hiring decisions and remove the obstacles. Step 9, early literacy. Without a doubt, schools in low-income areas are the ones that really need our focus. And that's what my budget prioritizes. Right now, more than half of Arizona schools offer voluntary full-day kindergarten. Parents love it, kids benefit from it, so I say, let's expand it. My budget gives the lowest income schools dollars to start or expand full-day kindergarten and address an issue we know is critical to closing the achievement gap, the ability to read by third grade. Step 10, tribal nations and rural schools. We also need to make sure that all of Arizona's kids are prepared for the 21st century. Many Arizona public schools are leading the nation when it comes to science and technology, teaching students to code and developing skills to take with them through their entire life. But too many students, specifically in our rural areas and tribal nations, are missing out. It's 2017, but outside of our urban areas, broadband is still spotty. Let's fix this by connecting these rural schools to high-speed internet, and let's couple it with a statewide computer science and coding initiative. This session, let's break the firewall and get these kids connected. And there's more. Step 11, principal academies to train school leaders. 12, loan forgiveness for our STEM teachers. 13, dollars for school construction and capital. 14, a per pupil boost for excelling schools. 15, even more for high quality, low income schools that are beating the odds. 16, career and technical education. 17, college knowing and going programs. And 18, achieve 60 AZ. Don't let anyone tell you we're not focused on K-12 education in the state of Arizona. We have a plan to prioritize K-12 education in a serious and thoughtful way, and we've only just begun. And when it comes to our children, we will always be tireless advocates. Every year, babies across the country are born with severe combined immunodeficiency, SCID. It's a rare genetic disorder that, if not detected early, is deadly. A baby born in Arizona today is automatically screened for a number of diseases, but not for SCID. Let's change that by adding SCID to the list. We have the power to save these precious human lives, so I'm asking the legislature to act with urgency. And if there's one headline we all dread reading every year, it's the one about the latest child left in a hot car, dying of heat stroke. In just minutes, temperatures escalate and a tragedy occurs. There's been a great amount of public education around this program, yet it still happens. Just one human life lost is one too many. All it takes is a good Samaritan to save a life, to be on the lookout, see movement, take action, and stop another death. The last thing we'd want is any Arizonan worried about breaking into a car to save a life. I've asked the legislature to send me a bill protecting the Good Samaritans who save the lives of children and pets, and I'll sign it. All of us who are blessed to be parents know the joy a child brings into our lives, not to mention the late nights. The bond between a newborn baby and its mother is uniquely special. Dr. Kara Christ, director of the Arizona Department of Health Services, a mom and an OBGYN, knows this well. She's expanded a successful program now deployed in two state agencies. It allows new moms and dads to bring their babies to work the first 6 months. The details have been impressive, and we plan to expand it even more. It's a win-win-win. Increased productivity, quality employees less likely to leave state service, and most important, happy babies. We know the best route to a better life for an individual and their family: a good paying and rewarding job. It's why I've been so focused on job creation these first 2 years. And in that time, we've seen more than 100,000 new private sector jobs land in our state. The best part is that we're seeing growth in both Maricopa County and Metro Tucson, as well as rural Arizona. Consumer confidence is up, and our housing market is on the move again. The word is out. Arizona is open for business. And the real credit goes to people like you, our business owners, your hardworking employees, and all our entrepreneurs. What we at the Capitol have done is simply get out of your way and let California move backwards with more nutty ideas. A tax on tech companies, their own version of cap and trade, emission standards, or get this, there's a new one, computer monitors. And who could forget harassing self-driving cars to drive themselves right out of California onto the I-10 and straight into Arizona. Thank you again, Jerry Brown. Another opportunity we have continued to seize is our vital commercial relationship with our largest trade partner, Mexico. Our work through the Arizona-Mexico Commission continues to lead the way, increasing trade and strengthening the relationship. I visited Sonora multiple times and was just in Mexico City last week to promote the state of Arizona. The month before that, I was in Nogales, Arizona, and joined by the U.S. Ambassador to Mexico to help launch the Unified Cargo Inspections Program. It's very clear to me why Nogales has become the envy of every other port on the U.S.-Mexico border. What the program demonstrates is that safety, security, and efficiency can all exist together. In fact, it has enhanced our security efforts by allowing Customs, Border Patrol, and Mexican Customs to focus on high-risk shippers while also facilitating trade encounters. Simply put, our economic and cultural ties with Mexico are thriving, and we have plans to make them even stronger going forward. We are doing all of this because it will create more jobs for Arizonans. And for Arizonans who are looking for work, we know the great value there is, the dignity in having a job, earning a living, providing for yourself and your family. No one wants to be on government assistance, but all too often, government incentivizes being out of a job rather than getting a job. So why not reward those who are making an honest effort to get off unemployment or food stamps or welfare? Those who are looking for work, making sure their kids do their homework, and trying to stop the cycle of poverty. For Arizonans who are actively looking for a job, who are getting their kids to school, let's extend them up to 12 additional months of cash assistance, known as HANF, is a bridge out of unemployment and out of poverty and into a better life. The safety of children in our state remains top of mind. In cases where the state must intervene, we are seeing some positive trends. For the first time in 7 years, more children are leaving the care of the state than entering it. We're closing cases and chipping away at the backlog of uninvestigated reports. And in the tragic situation of children who find themselves alone, without a loving home, we're placing them in one faster. This is an issue that is truly heartbreaking. As much as we try, government alone will never solve it. We'll never fully convince bad parents to be good parents. But we can save the lives of these children, and that's our goal every day. Our foster families are the unsung heroes in this tragedy, making real sacrifices to provide love to a child who needs it. To them, we can never say it enough. Thank you. We'll always be looking for ways to support them. One way we can help is by recognizing those who take in children in their own extended family. Aunts, uncles, grandfathers, and grandmothers who raise these children as their own. This is often a better option for a child than going to an unfamiliar family. But unlike other foster families, these family members receive little assistance for taking in their nephew or grandchild. So let's change that with a grandmother stipend, providing these families with the resources they need to raise these children. Many of our citizens have found themselves struggling because of an epidemic plaguing the entire country, drug addiction. It's a problem that knows no bounds. It affects men and women, young and old, rich and poor. We've, as a state, started to address it in a serious way. Cracking down on doc shopping, providing better treatment options, limiting first fill on opioids. Last week, I sent a letter to the Arizona Medical Board to require that all doctors in Arizona complete continuing education in drug addiction. We also need to make sure a second chance actually is a second chance. Vivitrol has been called a miracle drug, blocking heroin and painkiller addictions, even alcoholics, and allowing millions of Americans to gain their lives back. Also last week, I signed an executive order so that, effective immediately, people leaving our prison system have the opportunity to be treated with this blocker before they walk out the doors to maximize their success of never ever going back. Chances are addiction in some form has touched the lives of everyone gathered here today. None of us can overcome challenges in life without a support system. Every day, we all rely on friends and family, mentors and advocates. But sadly, many who have served their time don't have community support when they leave prison, making it that much harder. Through efforts like our community correction centers, we've made strides to bridge the gap, but more is needed. That's why I'm announcing an effort at the governor's office to engage the faith and nonprofit communities in being advocates for our citizens leaving prison and transitioning back into society. And inside our prisons, we'll be adding employment centers to help with things like building a resume and getting a job before the release date. It's the right thing to do. Last summer, I traveled to Navajo County to tour the damage caused by the Cedar Fire. Among the many brave firefighters I met was a group of inmates who enlisted in a program through the Department of Corrections. Every year, select inmates fight fires throughout Arizona. One of these men looked me in the eye and told me, "Governor, I felt like a zero. Now I feel like a hero." It's opportunities like this where corrections truly become corrections. And we need more of them so that over time, we can turn the tide and reduce our prison population, provide that second chance while also protecting public safety. And public safety will always be my top priority. That's why last year we came together and addressed an injustice long ignored, the backlog of untested rape kits in our state. The problem was so bad, we didn't even know how many existed. So we committed to fixing it, and already there have been 2 indictments as a result of this important work. My budget fully funds the testing of all remaining rape kits. And with the recommendations of our task force, we are ready to move forward with legislation requiring all future kits to be tested. So let's get this done. Some of our bravest officers have been part of a successful effort created last year, the Border Strike Force. This team is working 24/7 to keep Arizona safe, crack down on the cartels, stop the bad guys, and hunt down the criminals who are smuggling drugs and humans into our country. We couldn't accomplish any of these achievements around public safety without the work of our law enforcement agencies throughout the state. And let me say, we are truly indebted to the thousands of men and women who
wake up every day and put on blue, our cops. They keep our neighborhood safe. They walk into danger. They risk their lives. I want all our cops to know the state of Arizona values you. We value your work and your lives and your sacrifice. You have our back, and we will always have yours. We are blessed to live in not only a free country, but a secure one. And the credit for that goes to our brave men and women in the armed forces and our vets. For me, there was no more vivid reminder of the sacrifices they make than last month, the 75th anniversary of the attack on the USS Arizona at Pearl Harbor. Angela and I were honored to represent our state and spend time with the survivors. This truly was the greatest generation, and there's a lot we can still learn from them. But seeing our young soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines standing beside these heroes, it was clear. This new generation of Americans is the next greatest generation. If there's one thing we can agree on, it's this. Arizona is, without a doubt, the most beautiful state in the country. This year marks the 60th anniversary of Arizona Parks. From the red rocks of Sedona to the cool caves of Karcher Caverns, there is so much beauty for us to celebrate. I was happy to announce free admission for all Arizona residents at all state parks and trails over Martin Luther King Day weekend. So I hope you all got the chance to put down your iPhone, get outside, and enjoy some fresh air with your family, and take pride in living here. And if you didn't, I'm going to expect you to do it next week. You know, Arizona is not without its challenges. But there's no doubt about it. Life really is better here. We are home to some of the top-ranked public schools in the nation, the most innovative university in the country. And in a few months, the NCAA Final Four is going to tip off right across the street. By working with our citizens these last 2 years, and across the aisle, with civility and respect, we've seen what is possible in Arizona. Positive outcomes in our schools. Safe communities, a more reliable water future that allows us to thrive in the desert, and an economy that embraces innovation. Let's keep that going so that the next Raul Castro, or Rose Mofford, or maybe even the next Sandra Day O'Connor can display their grit, will, and determination, and enjoy the boundless opportunities that exist in Arizona and in America. Thank you. Thank you for having me, and God bless.
Came up here, so there we go. Okay, you've hit a lot of the points that we had to ask for you. So I'm going to start with healthcare. Healthcare in the West Valley is our leading industry, representing some of the largest employers, major employers in this region. Equally, obviously, it's very important for the state and to you. So how do you think that the repeal and replace will affect this vibrant healthcare economy for our state?
It's a great question. It's incredibly topical right now. I've been outspoken that I believe that Obamacare is a monumental failure and a rolling disaster. For instance, in Arizona, before 2008, we had 20-plus insurance providers in all 15 of our counties. Fast forward to today, and we have only one provider in 14 out of 15 counties. Our premiums are up an average of 50%, and in many places up 100%. So I'm going to be in Washington, D.C. tomorrow. Governors are going to have a seat at the table on this replacement. I believe in repeal, but the skill is in replacement. And I don't want to see any Arizona citizen have the rug pulled out from underneath them as a result of this transition. I just had discussions this morning with one of the senators that is leading the task force back in D.C., and I want to make sure that we're focused on patients and doctors first, while at the same time realizing we have an incredible hospital system here in the state of Arizona. I want to see more choice and competition amongst our insurance providers, and I also want to respect the pharmaceutical drug makers who do provide miracle drugs in many situations. I just want to make certain that those drugs are affordable and accessible to our citizens. So this is something, what I've said when interviewed on this is, my advice to Washington is, how about this time you read the bill? So I know there's a lot of discussion around this, but I'm someone that thinks we have some time here. We should be thoughtful. We should bring the right people to the table. This should be a bipartisan fix, and that's what I'll be advocating for. There's a sense of urgency, and it's a real focal point right now, but I do think in addition to the repeal, the skill is in the replacement, and the good news is Leader McCarthy gets this. He's reaching out to governors. Vice President-elect Pence understands this. He was a former governor in Indiana and understands how this program affected his state. He was also a skilled legislator at the federal level. So I have a lot of confidence that we're going to get this done and that you're going to see this play out in broad daylight, and I think that's a good thing.
Just a couple more. So infrastructure is the foundation of economic development, and we're so fortunate to have Loop 303, Loop 202 coming on board, the 101, and really our proximity to California, as you alluded earlier. We want to capture that business coming in. We still have needs, though, in terms of infrastructure, and I'm sure you've heard this before. So while technology and driver behaviors are rapidly changing, we still need to find a consistent, reliable funding source, being that our gas tax has not been increased since 1991. What's the balance here in terms of preparing for the future?
It's a great question, and it's something that's incredibly important in terms of our growth as a state. Our infrastructure, the roads and bridges and overpasses, are really the economic backbone for the state of Arizona. It's part of the reason I was so focused in my first year on balancing the budget. We had tens of millions of dollars swept from our HERF funds to be used as a gimmick to call the budget balanced. We've gotten past that point. We can now start investing again in the state of Arizona, but the lion's share of these dollars traditionally come from our federal government. Our president-elect has said if he wants to see a major infrastructure project and spending in the United States, and if you look at a heat map of infrastructure that's already been invested in our country, you would see the eastern half, east of the Mississippi, be much more heavily built up and invested than the western half. Yet you see the population migration from east to west.
So I think there's a number of breakthrough projects that Arizona can be a part of, and as your governor, and someone who has relationships with this new administration, that's something that I'll be advocating for back in Washington, D.C., while making certain that our budget is balanced here and we have available dollars for the appropriate projects. And in addition to infrastructure, I talked about roads and bridges and overpasses, and of course that's part of it, the ports at our border. It's also the way we communicate, that we have all areas of the state so that cell phones and broadband and the internet is accessible. That allows us to be more competitive. As I sit at the table with these business owners and leaders and influencers and decision makers and find out what's important to them as either they exit California or looking for a place to build out their supply chain. It's something we can really pitch in the state of Arizona as one of our assets, but it's something we need to improve on. We're in a dynamic economy with other states that are also competing for many of these same businesses. And so far so good. In this first 2 years, we've got some incredible successes, but more is needed. Our pipeline's full, and I want to make sure that we're going to be competitive as we're in these negotiations.
One more question for you. Governor, huge, huge, huge kudos to you for all the work that you've done in the past 4 years, past 2 years, in repairing and revitalizing our relationship with Mexico. You've done a tremendous job, and you've been extremely successful. So given the recent statements by President-elect Trump, how do you plan to influence federal decisions that affect Arizona's strong trade relationship with Mexico and all the work that you've done?
One of the things I'm certain of is that our new incoming president is going to be concerned about American jobs. And for Arizona, our economy grows and thrives because of our relationship with Mexico. And I'll give you a perfect example. I was able to announce about a month ago, Lucid Motors Company selecting Arizona, Casa Grande specifically, as its manufacturing site. This is a breakthrough technology in electric cars that will be coming to the state of Arizona to manufacture. They looked at 60 different markets in 13 different states. And one of the final questions I was asked in the negotiation was, how is your relationship with Mexico? And I said, I think it's great, but why don't we ask them? They flew to Sonora, Mexico. They met with Governor Claudia Pavlovich, who's the first female governor of Mexico. And her economic advisors, they came back and selected Arizona. We were able to make that announcement on the front steps of the Capitol in front of a statewide audience with an article that was actually written in USA Today. So I'm a big believer in free trade, and I know there's discussion around fair trade as well. I think that this discussion will help the state of Arizona. I think it's important that when we're focusing on economic development, job creation, business relocation, we keep solidly on that foundation. And while at the same time, we realize there are other issues that we want our federal government to address, like immigration, like border security. But we can still continue to grow with Arizona. Mexico is our largest trading partner, and it's not even close. It's times four. So I was just in Mexico City last weekend. We get an incredible reception. Every time we go there, the hospitality is overwhelming, and I'm looking forward to being in Washington, D.C. this week and advocating what I think will be good policy, not only for Arizona, but for America.
Am I still on? Governor, thank you so much. On behalf of the WESTMARC membership, the local cities and towns, local government, state government that's in the room today, our business community and our education community, thank you so much for sharing your time with us today. Membership growth, financial stability in our coppers, a strong focus on promoting the West Valley's skilled workforce. And for more about this, I invite you to attend our annual business meeting coming up on February 23rd. It's a breakfast hosted by ASU at, or hosted by WESTMARC at ASU West, and that's at 8 a.m. Speaking of workforce, I think that we have a tremendous workforce in the West Valley. I know we do. 69% of us leave every day and we go to other parts of the region for work. So we're really highly skilled here, and this is a place to bring jobs to. I'd like to thank my workforce, Christina Bossler, for every single detail of this event. She makes things stress-free for me to work on. And our newest team member, Kimberly Jordan. And talking about the future, I'd like to thank Elise Nillis, Jeremy Kraut, and Drew Sandstrom, and they are all either recent graduates of ASU or they're still in school. So I encourage you to meet with them because our focus is to make sure that we are meeting and we're providing opportunities for our youth so that we keep them here in the West Valley. And then finally, Heather Kim, she's another one of our volunteers. So once again, thank you for joining us today. Thanks for the attendees, and thanks to you all as attendees and our sponsors. Thank you. Have a great day.